Hey there! Thank you for tuning into Duck Bricks, and welcome to another episode of Bionicle Fan and Reviews, the show where I review all the fan-created, canonized Bionicle models. These models are not official LEGO sets, but instead have been officially accepted into LEGO canon either via the 05 Dark Hunter and Rahi contests, sponsored directly by LEGO, or through more modern stuff like the TTV canonization contest, currently being overseen by Greg Farshtey, the writer of the Bionicle storyline. Today's topic is one of the winners from the Dark Hunter contest all the way back in 05. This is the Dark Hunter Mimic. Now, Mimic has a pretty tragic backstory. He is only working for the Dark Hunters because the Shadowed One promised that he would task any available Dark Hunters to search for his missing loved one, or I guess close companion, because love isn't quite canon in the Bionicle universe. Essentially, how the story goes is that he was once living very peacefully alongside one of his closest companions and friends, until one day that friend mysteriously disappeared. Distraught by grief, Mimic was trying to do everything in his power to locate his friend when the Shadowed One came to him with a proposition. "I will help you find your friend if you help me and lend your skills as a warrior to the Dark Hunters." So oftentimes, Mimic is forced to participate in the Dark Hunter activities as a reluctant assassin or a reluctant attacker, mostly because he's really only doing it to enlist the Shadowed One's help in finding his companion. Little does he know that the Shadowed One had been watching him for most of his life. Impressed by his fighting prowess, the Shadowed One kidnapped his friend, imprisoned them inside the Dark Hunter's fortress, and made it such that Mimic never knows that his companion has actually been imprisoned within the Dark Hunter fortress this entire time. A pretty good way to keep an employee on retainer, if you ask me. But storyline aside, let me now move on to the four key points in which I'll be reviewing this model on. Number one is posability. So can I get this into good poses without it falling over? Are there any stability issues? Or generally, does it pose well? Number two is building techniques. So is this just borrowing different aspects of existing sets and cobbling them together, or is it actually trying to do something new and unique? Number three is overall aesthetics. So am I generally happy with how it looks agnostic of story? Do I actually like how the color scheme works out and the color blocking of this model, and so on? And number four is believability in universe. So does this make sense as a character in the Bionicle universe? Do I actually believe it as a member of the Bionicle canon and as a member of the Dark Hunters, and does it scale well next to other Bionicle characters? Let's dive into all of that and more as we take a look at the Dark Hunter Mimic.
Alright, so here we have in front of us the Dark Hunter Mimic. You can see that starting off, just going around, it generally appears to be a pretty solid model. Doesn't look to be any immediate stability issues because it is basically just a simple Metru build, with just a few embellishments made on the sides of the legs and the arms. This obviously comes with its pros and cons. Unlike many of the other Dark Hunters, you won't face any major issues getting this guy into a good pose. He's not very top or back heavy, and generally he's about the same size as a standard Toa build, so really you're not going to run into many stability or posing issues. That being said though, it is a Metru build to a fault. So obviously, you can have the whole gear function in the back to have these swinging arms, which is a nice function, keeping it very much in line with the sets, but then that also means that, like every single other Metru build, you can't actually get him to hold up his weapon in a generally good pose because it will just flop right down, not because of a lack of friction in the joints, but because of the way that the gear ratio is set up, such that there's no friction in the gears. And it really just goes up and down, just like this. But let's just start things off immediately with posability. Now, the one thing that you may notice is that it actually has an additional set of ball joints along the sides of the legs. Unfortunately, these do not do anything. So you might be wondering, why exactly do the upper legs have the ball joints angled this way? Well, I'll tell you, I was really disappointed to see this. They literally took the front legs of a Kikinalo from the standard LEGO sets, like just the regular Kikinalo legs, added this transparent neon orange saw blade to the sides, and literally called it a day. There was not even any attempt to modify it such that even if they didn't want to integrate the secondary ball joints for increased stability for articulation, they didn't even remove it or try to take it off or have it connect to something else. No, it's literally just using the Kikinalo legs, which are pulled straight from a set. Which is a little bit disappointing, I will say, more on the building technique side of things than anything, because it's really not offering you anything new, literally just taking stuff exactly from the sets. And it also does this with the feet as well. The feet are generally just ripped from the standard foot build for the Kikinalo. So really not a great use of parts there. Honestly, I probably would have wanted to see something a little bit more unique. That being said though, I do appreciate the inclusion of the transparent neon orange saw blade, because that at least keeps it kind of in line with other aspects of the color scheme, specifically the eye color. But of course, posability wise, while these don't do anything, you can just move the legs pretty much any way you would expect. It has this whole new, or at least this is a new construction, where they've taken the Wenua claw digger pieces and placed them as knee pads, and also adhered them onto a standard Metru Toa underside or ball joint area piece here. So at least this is offering something a little bit new. It's nothing crazy at all. I mean, it's just standard building techniques, but the lower leg is unique to this figure, and you can just bend it up and down as you would need. Really nothing restricting articulation per se. It's just kind of strange how it's just literally taken straight from the sets. Moving on to the arms, again, there's really nothing out of the ordinary, or at least what you would expect in terms of a Metru build. You can angle this ball joint really any way that you would want for a Metru. And the other thing is that the hand, since the way that it's adhered on the ball joint is kind of stuck on this standard angle here, you can't actually rotate the hand individually. You can only move it back and forth, but at least for this lower arm piece, you can still rotate that around, so it's not a huge, huge deal to me. It again is recycling other stuff from other sets. This time it's recycling the Makuta Pterodax hand technique, using the Evoki here as sort of the hands of this character. And you've also got a very similar thing going on using this whole armor piece from the Toa Metru on top of two Borok eyes, which is also borrowed from existing sets. So a lot of this build is kind of a hodgepodge of stuff that actually came in the official sets. Of course, the weapon is brand new for this figure. It's basically very simple. Nothing too much to say about that one. It's using the Kopakanuva ski pieces alongside a Toa Tahu sword. Really just a basic weapon, but honestly, I think it looks alright. I do like that you can actually get it into some poses, because if you just angle the Metru arm such that maybe you're resting the other arm on the back here, forcing it to hold the weapon up, you can at least get him to actually hold the weapon up, so that is a pro over some of the other Dark Hunters. And of course, looking at the head, it is pretty unique, I will say. You've got the Kanohi Evoki, and typically I don't really like the use of these great or legendary masks in mocks, because they really are very specific to one character. But thankfully what this person has done is that they've actually taken the backside of the Evoki and changed it around such that he has a completely unique face. If you look at this face here, you've placed the Borok eyes along these sides, and you have some sort of a circular gear-like mouth. It's definitely a unique look and feel. I at least can very clearly parse what the head is supposed to be. I can very clearly see, all right, these are the eyes, you've got some spikes going down, and this maybe is some sort of a mouth or something, or a speaker. So I can very clearly see what the head is supposed to be, and mounting it upside down backwards on a Metru head is certainly a unique innovation, something that makes this one stand out quite a lot, but obviously not the most refined of builds. It's very, very simple, although it does actually work, I think, as a face. I don't know what I would have done to change it up even more than this, but it generally does its job all right. Of course, moving on from posability to building techniques, the torso is literally just a standard Metru torso, nothing crazy going on whatsoever. It's literally just a black Metru torso with one extra armor piece added on in a very similar fashion to the Toa Norik set from 2005. Of course, the only thing that actually makes this kind of unique compared to the other Metru builds are the very large shoulders here. They've actually included the gear pieces to accentuate the roundness of the shoulders, which is something I do think works out relatively well. I actually do kind of like how these gears are really accentuated and make it feel like these shoulders are really beefy. Gives it a bit of a unique look for being a Metru build. It actually doesn't look too similar to some of the other Metru builds, thanks to the unique legs, although they are borrowed from an existing set. At least they're pretty unique, and you've got these gear pieces, which are completely unique, that actually make it have a very interesting silhouette when you have it posed up. In terms of the building techniques for the rest of it, honestly, I can't say too much. This is honestly one of the canon models that felt the closest to building an actual Bionicle set, and there are pros and cons to that because, well, as I said, it's literally taking stuff from existing sets, like the lower arms technique is taken right from existing sets, these legs are literally just pulled from the Kikinalo, and so are the feet, so yes, it does feel like you're building a legitimate LEGO Bionicle model, but I honestly did not feel like I was encountering anything new here with the building techniques. Nothing it did really surprised me or made me really appreciate the way it was built whatsoever. This all just came together in a very standard position, which, again, both good and bad. I honestly probably would have liked to see something a little bit different other than just a standard Metru build with the legs borrowed from another existing set. But then again, it is stable, you don't have any stability issues, it's not fragile or using any illegal techniques, it's literally just the most legal techniques possible because it's pulling straight from sets, and you can generally get it into okay poses. So honestly, bit of a mixed bag for me. Nothing that blew me away in terms of building techniques, but nothing where I was like, oh, they shouldn't be doing this, or something that felt illegal or felt like it was dealing serious damage to the pieces. So again, bit of a mixed bag here. But then moving on from building techniques, we can talk about aesthetics a little bit, completely agnostic to the universe. I think the one thing that I do appreciate about this is the consistency in the color scheme, especially since it's literally just borrowing stuff from existing sets. The pearl dark gray on the legs from the Kikinalo actually works out pretty well with the dark gray lower legs in the back here. Got a dark gray foot. And you've also got the dark gray upper arms. I do like the usage of the trans neon orange pieces again, which do feel like they're reflections of his armor, and even though that the rest of the weapons and some of the underside of the pieces are red, like specifically you've got some red pieces here, the hands are red because, again, they're likely just taken from the Makuta set, at least it is doing something a little bit consistent by having this trans neon orange color be a reddish sort of highlight, and making it feel like the color scheme is generally a consistent black, silver, dark gray with some red or orange highlights. The other thing that I can say that worked out pretty well for this are the proportions. The proportions are generally quite good and even better than some of the official sets, thanks to the leg technique being used directly from the Kikinalo, making it stand up just a little bit taller, and the hands just swing down to the sides right about where they should be in a standard humanoid. So really, there's nothing that extraordinary about this, but it also doesn't feel like it's too crazy or too weird. This just feels like a standard warrior that could exist in the Bionicle world. But speaking of making sense in the world of Bionicle, let's zoom out now and take a look at how this model compares against other representative samples from the Bionicle universe.
Alright, so here we have the Dark Hunter Mimic alongside some representative samples from the Bionicle universe. I've brought along the Kikinalo specifically to showcase that the upper leg of the Kikinalo is literally the upper leg of this character, and the lower leg of the Kikinalo is literally the lower arm of this character. So they definitely just took these bits and threw them on here. Also, the feet are also the feet of this character. They're literally identical. So basically, all the parts of the legs of the Kikinalo are recycled in this character. Feels a little cheap, to be honest, to me, but just wanted to showcase that. I've also brought alongside one of the other random Toa Metru, in this case Toa Metru Oniwa. This is to really signify the height difference, even though this is basically just a Metru build, because it uses such longer limb segments, specifically the Kikinalo limb segments, it actually is much, much taller than your standard Toa Metru build, which is pretty interesting, I will say. Of course, I think that believability in-universe for this model has to be pretty high, again, because it's literally just taking stuff from existing sets. There's not much you can do to mess it up because you're literally taking existing sets and making use of their parts for your own model. So of course it makes sense that this would fit in the universe. In fact, it looks really similar to stuff that's in the universe. You've got the same hand technique used for old Pterodactyls, you've got the upper legs, lower legs, and feet from the Kikinalo, and the only thing that throws me off a little bit is the use of the Kanohi Evoki, because of course he would not actually have this, But then again, I mean, it is rotated backwards. You don't really even see it from the front. So I would actually count this as an acceptable use of one of the more famous masks. A lot of times people just slap a Kraken on the model or even just slap an Evokeon and call it good. Just front-facing standard configuration. I'm not a big fan of that because it just doesn't make sense in the story how someone's face would just so closely resemble some famous artifact or mask. But for this instance, since it's really on the back of the head, it's really just taking advantage of the front spikes of the mask, I think I'll give it a bit of a pass there. So in terms of believability in universe, I'm going to give this model a 10 out of 10. It fits in very well with the rest of the Bionicle world, and really does feel like a model that would be built from an official LEGO set, which in some cases it literally is. But then setting aside the representative models, let's just dive deeper into the three remaining points for this model, starting off with just posability. So posability, as I mentioned, is pretty standard. You can get him into good poses. He's not going to fall over. Of course, you have the articulation of the gear function just being recycled from the Metru builds here, which does kind of prevent you from raising up the weapons or arms in certain configurations. But if you're creative about it, like if you take one arm, move it around the back here, kind of locking this arm in, then you can kind of raise the weapon up in some semblance of an attack. A lot of people who are familiar with messing around with Metru builds are probably used to having to do some of those tricks to keep one arm in behind so they can raise one arm up. So definitely it has the same cons of articulation as any standard Metru build does. What does bug me a little bit is the added articulation. Specifically, you've got these extra ball joints that don't actually go anywhere. Feels very out of place to me. That's some unwanted articulation detailing on the legs there. And then you've also got this kind of whole open ball joints from the Kikinalo feet, which again, the Kikinalo also had open ball joints, and it just feels kind of awkward to have the foot mounted on such an area where there's an entire front section that isn't connected to anything. And so for posability, I think I'm going to give this one an 8 out of 10. There's no stability issues whatsoever. You can get it into decent poses, but there are a few things that make it weird or stand out of place, specifically the way that the legs are constructed because the builder was just recycling existing stuff. Moving on though, to building techniques, I think this is probably where I'm going to have to hit it the hardest because I'm just not a huge, huge fan of submitting a model for a canon contest that literally recycles, I would say, at least half of it is just made up of recycled stuff. The feet, the upper legs, the lower arms, to an extent the torso and the upper arms too, because it's basically just a Metru build. And even the hands are just taken from a Titan. So really the only unique thing here is the lower leg segment, the head, and the weapon. So not a huge, huge fan that that's the only unique aspect of this model. Probably would have wanted to see something a little bit more special done for something submitted as a canon model, especially for a contest. Kind of feels cheap to just recycle stuff from the sets. So building techniques, I think I'm gonna have to give this one a 6 out of 10. It's fine, obviously. I mean, it's built well. It won't have stability issues. You even have a play feature and everything. But it just feels a little cheap to recycle stuff for a canon contest. So that's why I'm going to give it a bit of a lower score on building techniques. It's not that the building techniques are bad per se. Just kind of boring because I felt like I'd built this model before while I was building it for the first time. And then, of course, moving on to aesthetics. I think aesthetics is generally all right. You've got some highlight colors in the red and transparent neon orange, which do actually feel like it is something special for this character. You took a Metru build and you actually have given it some longer legs, and it feels like it has a bit of a taller stature, especially compared to a standard Toa Metru. So that is definitely cooler for aesthetics. It has similar proportions to the existing sets, but does it at a bit of a larger scale. And I do actually appreciate the large gears on the tops of the shoulders here, which give it some extra personality and added flair. That being said though, again, it's really, really awkward how it has these extra ball joints that literally go nowhere, just recycled from the Kikinalo set. It's also got a lot of open ball joints here that don't go to anywhere, so feels like something was supposed to connect there, maybe just some blades or additional armor. Just kind of strange how there are open ball joints here, and then open sockets as well on the feet, which is a problem that the Kikinalo also had. So all in all, if you just look closer and closer at it, it just starts to feel a little bit strange and awkward in the way that certain things are built, again, because it's recycling stuff from the sets. But in terms of overall aesthetics, I think it's going to get a 7 out of 10. It's generally not bad. It is an imposing warrior. It's pretty tall compared to the others. But it also has a lot of awkward stuff because it's just reusing stuff from the sets. And when it's not reusing stuff, it has these strange parts usages like the dark red pelvis pieces here, which do feel a little bit out of place, at least color scheme wise. And of course, the open ball joints don't do anything to help it in that regard. But I think with that, we've about summed up our look at the Dark Hunter Mimic. Let me know down in the comments below, what do you think of this model? If any of you have this built, how is the model for you? And as usual, stay tuned every single Monday, unless otherwise stated, for a brand new Bionicle Fan and Review coming out where I'll be reviewing every fan-created canon Bionicle model. Thank you so much for tuning in. Be sure to like and subscribe, and I'll talk to you again very, very soon. Bye-bye for now.